I'm going to give you an overarching summary of the workshop contributions this year. The theme of the week was, as you know, water and food security. And a core component of the program has been 8 workshops addressing issues of water efficiency, health, food supply chain, water, food, energy nexus, etc. The background to the workshops is the increasing water imbalances in the world's food security situation. Areas with high population growth face severe problems associated with poverty and low adaptive capacity. In addition, climate change is increasing rainfall, unpredictability, rate of evapotranspiration, and occurrence of extreme events. This presentation summarizes both the inputs to the workshops to be found in the abstract volume and selected from 800 abstracts offered to us in February, and some reporting from the workshops. My conceptual approach will be to see water and food as a landscape-based activity, but also as an activity in need of governance responses for its sound management. In this presentation, efforts involved in safeguarding water for food is organized along 2 basic perspectives. The first, the landscape-related issues in terms of food production and links to the landscape, and the second, governance-related issue. At the end, I will come with some personal comments. Now, to the landscape-related issues, food production-oriented contributions represented a range of perspectives. Climate and rain-related issues, including climate change variability for maize production in US and rainwater management strategies in India. Blue water-based irrigation, including micro-irrigation from Austria and drip irrigation from Israel, and the role of return flow in terms of reuse from Spain and Egypt. Nutrient-oriented inputs highlighted urine-based, so-called yellow economy from Australia, nutrient recovery from Sweden, and Ecosan approach from Burkina Faso. Water storage was exemplified with sand dams from Germany and on-farm storage from UK. On these issues, the rain-fed workshop concluded that unlocking the potential in rain-fed agricultural systems depends on successful rainwater management, well adapted to the respective agroecological zones. While the methods are well known and tested, the implementation depends on many factors besides water, such as soil fertility, electricity, roads, market, credit, etc. The blue water-oriented workshop paid much attention to irrigation efficiency, water storage and storage refilling, and aquifer recharge and rehabilitation. They concluded that as water use increases and drives towards closing basins, the task of governing water allocation becomes a true challenge. Wastewater reuse is the next issue. It was exemplified in terms of energy cost in US, guidelines in Sri Lanka, recycling in Bangladesh, health risk and water safety plans in Netherlands and US, and peri-urban agriculture in India. On this issue, the urban workshop discussed the city metabolism and the urban water and food nexus, cities as source of water and nutrients for agriculture, and treatment systems to help closing the urban nutrient cycle, together with synergies and efficiency considerations. They concluded that awareness raising and capacity building is critical. On the links to the surrounding landscape, there were a number of contributions regarding, for example, links to peri-urban production in terms of polyculture from India, agroforestry production from India as well, groundwater recharge in terms of a scheme for infiltrating treated wastewater from Jordan, salinity intrusion from India. Upstream-downstream linkages from Ethiopia, and payments and subsidies following the idea of the Tana River case from Brazil. Hydropower focusing on Amazon River from US, and Yunnan as a South Asian water tower from Netherlands, and cumulative impacts from Germany. Biofuels in terms of feedstock production from India and use of biogas from slaughterhouses from Nigeria, and prospective use of the methane from Lake Turkana from Congo. Needs for landscape scale management of rainwater from Ethiopia, better landscape management in the Andes from UK, and the need for better coupling to ecological services for reducing the trend towards livelihood degradation and out-migration from Ethiopia. On the latter issue, one of the workshops concluded that in a landscape level approach, both food security and ecosystem health depend on a bundled view on ecosystem services. This means a need for a new mechanism that can engage a broad range of stakeholders around benefit of sharing ecosystem services. Proceeding now to the governance-related issues, in terms of social system activities, there were presentations on human health, including malaria control from Nigeria, sanitation, including food security from Bolivia, health risks from Netherlands, and water safety plan from US. Here, the health workshop concluded that to ensure a reduction of health risks in the reuse of water of varying quality, while including nutrient recycling and irrigation, concepts such as water fit for purpose and use fit for different purposes could be applied. On valuation-oriented contributions, there was one on pricing in terms of modeling from South Africa, on shared value from US, on trade, including preference for imported food from Indonesia, and blue-green components in trade from Argentina. On the latter issue, the trade workshop noted the very uneven global water resource distribution in relation to food needs, which makes it rational to trade agricultural products between water-rich areas able to produce a surplus and areas where import may be the best option for food security. The scope and scale of evolving trade is unlike anything before. On policy and management-oriented contributions, there was one on the need for global water governance, including some moral concerns from Germany. One to facilitate multiple use from South Africa, and one on IWRM from Indonesia, and the inclusion of an ecosystem approach from Netherlands. Effective institutions in terms of water use association was presented from India and Serbia, village committees from Nepal, examples from Sri Lanka and USA, and a DFID review from United Kingdom of 25,000 articles concluding that outcome-oriented policy analysis is woefully lacking. On the nexus of energy, water, and food in terms of needs for coherent policies, there was a contribution from Thailand. On this issue, the Nexus workshop concluded that in implementing the nexus between water, food, and energy pricing, opportunity cost and trade-offs must be addressed. And in practice, this calls for pragmatism rather than dogmatism. The governance workshop finally discussed IWRM as enabling environment through policies, institutions, and management instruments. The business community perspective on increasing food security and the role of government and international financing institutions. If you now allow me, I would finally like to add some personal comments. First of all, the ecosystem perspective trend is slowly developing. There are basically three types of input. One type is the impact-oriented contributions, those cause-related, highlighting hydropower and livestock intensification, and those response-related, highlighting nutrient pollution, engineered rivers, river restoration. The second type is inputs in terms of system-oriented approaches, addressing ecosystem bundles in West Africa to identify livelihood strategies. The role, and furthermore, the role of ecosystem services for avoiding out-migration and poverty trap, and agriculture as ecosystem service provider for sustainable delivery of food and water security. And the third type focused on the role of ecosystems in water resources planning, water use synergies, payment for ecological services, entering ecosystem services in IWRM. What has surprised me to take the next point is that the short-term perspective has been so dominating in the contributions that I have met related to how to improve today's food production. I would, for instance, have expected much more attention to the new water scarcity. The fact that irrigated production in broad global breadbasket regions is based on overexploited groundwater aquifers gets only featherlight touch. There was one interesting assessment on the much debated global food waste, suggesting that food products never consumed appropriate some 10 to 20% of agricultural use of water, of cropland area, and of fertilizers. My next point. Surprisingly enough, not much attention has been paid to the long-term, multi-decadal perspective, in spite of the enormous challenges to be expected in feeding a growing humanity. I found basically three such inputs only. Two addressing the situation in the late 21st century, one on the situation in Southeast Asia, and one on a new green-blue water scarcity indicator. The large-scale future dependence on trade was addressed in one contribution on the need for global coordination of the food market, and another one on an in-depth analysis of drawbacks of the virtual water concept. Forward-looking management practices was addressed mainly by Ethiopia in terms of landscape-scale rain management practices, elsewhere discussed as land stewardship for securing wetting of the landscape. This was the closest we came to addressing the land-water disconnect issue highlighted by UNEP in its 2012 report on future emerging issues. Finally, the need for conceptual clarity taken up by Ukraine is really worth attention. This observation is indeed extremely up to date at this point in time in view of the stress on something called green production, which I would think is something linked to rain-fed agriculture or to wetland production rather than economic theory. This is an excellent example of the growing dominance in our vocabulary of expressions from the political world, preferring catchy concepts rather than explanation-driven concepts. Thank you.